Hi, once again, you are welcome to GSET Tutorials. On this platform, we teach you how to study social studies the simple way and answer social studies questions correctly. So I'm here with another interesting lesson concerning law and order in our community. So this time around, I'll be shifting to one interesting aspect of that topic, and I want you to keep to your screen, be attentive. Follow me closely as we delve into that. I want us to look at the meaning of law, and then we'll look at how Parliament makes laws in Ghana. So in Ghana, we call it Parliament, or people refer to it as the Parliament House. So in the Parliament House, we have legislators, and the legislators work in the legislature. So the legislature is the law-making arm of government. So they make the laws for us. So we have the members of parliament in our legislature, and they are the ones who make the laws for us. These laws made for us, we call them statutory laws or state laws. And how do they come about with these laws? I began by saying that we call ours parliament, that's our legislature. When you go to other countries like America, they call it the Congress. Then when you go to parts of you go to Japan, you go to India, they call it the Diet, D-I-E-T. And then when you get to Israel, they call it the Knesset. So their law-making bodies referred to as the Knesset. So K-N-E-S-S-E-T. Then we have Germany. Germany, they call theirs the Bundestag. The Bundestag, B-U-N-D-E-S-T-A-G. That is how they also call theirs. When you get to British, get the British or Great Britain, they call theirs the Parliament as well. So just like we also call ours. Now we are going to look at how Parliament makes laws for the state in Ghana, the processes and the stages that they go through, and what they have to do to make sure that we have a statutory law. Alright, so before we go into that, we look at the meaning of law. But when we say law, law is just the rules of conduct of a particular society. So in your home, there are rules of conduct that you have to follow or obey. And the rules of conduct are made by a legislation or an authority. And they are enforced by the same people. So at home, your parents make rules and regulations for you, and they enforce them. So your parents will be regarded as an authority at home. When you go to the churches, we have the pastors, the leaders, the bishops over there. They are also making rules of conduct. What is going to actually regulate the behavior of the people in the community? So these people come together and then put all these things across, either in a written form or in a spoken form. They can come out with the rules of conduct and how people under them should behave, especially their followers. When you come to the school, you as students out there watching, you know in schools we have rules governing every school. And these rules, we have them being made by GES. And when you come to your own school, so there are certain basic rules that they also make for the students to follow and obey. And that will promote order. So that is the meaning of law. But when you come to order, so when the law exists and it is being enforced by the authority, your parents enforce, your teachers enforce them, the people in government, especially the executive, the people, institutions like the security agencies, the police, the armed forces, the navy, and prison service, and all these institutions come together to enforce the law. What is going to happen is that people's lives will be regulated, and it's going to lead to order. And so what is order? The situation where there is what? An acceptable social behavior, or an acceptable social behavior is observed. A situation where an acceptable social behavior is observed. So I hope you've gotten the definition for law and the definition for order. We'll quickly go into the stages of lawmaking by Parliament in Ghana. So let's go into them and see. We're going to look at 10 stages. So we take stage 1 and see what we have over there. So under stage one, a proposal or a bill, a proposal or bill is read to Parliament by the Clerk of Parliament. So the clerk is one of the officials in the House. When I say the House, I'm referring to the House of Parliament where the laws are made. So as they are seated, the clerk is there. But it is assumed that most or all the members of Parliament around that time have not had copies of the bill. So when we talk about the bill or the proposal, the bill is the raw state of a law. The raw state of a law. So the bill will now be cooked. That's why you pass it through a certain process before it becomes a law. So it has not become a law yet. We still call it a bill or a proposal. So normally this proposal will come in the form of government policies from government, the executive, because the executive is also one of the arms of government, and that is where the president is. So when they forward it to the House of Parliament, then they will look at it, sit down, and then take it through the processes. So if you pick the Right to Information Bill that was passed recently, you realize that it has to come from the public were pushing for that, the media houses were pushing for that. Then it got to the executive, they decided to put it into place, but they can't do that alone, so they have to forward it to the lawmaking body. So it came to Parliament as a bill or a proposal. Then it has to be read to the House the first time. So this is the first reading. So the clerk is the one who does the reading, and all the parliamentarians will have copies of the bill or the proposal, what is before them. Then what next? Stage two. Alright. Okay, so under stage two, the speaker refers the bill to an appropriate committee for it to study and make recommendations or give recommendations. So when the bill after stage one is read by the clerk, then a committee will be appointed. Now let's take note of certain things under this step. Here in Parliament, they can set up committees. So we can have what we call an ad hoc committee. Ad hoc committee, or we can have what we call a standing committee. So with ad hoc committee, we can also call them the temporal committee. These one, the temporal ones are dissolved. They are to work and consider whatever has been put in that document. So they look at it and go through, and then they will make their considerations, and then they will make recommendations, what they have observed, what they have seen. Then that is the temporal. So immediately they are done with their work, they dissolve them. But the standing ones are permanent ones. So these permanent committees, most of the time, what they do is that they are being set up by Parliament, and they don't dissolve them because their work has to continue. So they forward whatever document to them and they look at it. So it will be, if it is on finance, it will go to the finance committee and they will deal with it. If it is on talking about agric, there should be a committee there that will oversee that. If it is on any sector, health, there should be a health committee that will oversee that and they will take care of that. So these ones are permanent, and most parliament houses have them. But with the ad hoc one, the temporal ones, when they do make their consideration and then they make their recommendation, they dissolve those committees. So the ad hoc ones are temporal, the standing ones are permanent. So we need to take note of that. So one committee will be appointed and then will be chaired by one person, the leader. And then you will have to study the bill or the proposal that has been brought before Parliament, and then they will make their recommendation or give their recommendation. That is what we have under stage two. So we go quickly into stage three. So they are in processes. You don't have to miss a stage. Okay. It's just like you are preparing the food And then step by step, you don't put everything there before. You have to set fire, get the ingredients, and then even prepare some of the ingredients before you start cooking. So it's a process thing. Okay. Stage three. All right. Under stage three, the chairman of the committee presents the bill to parliament for study. So you remember a committee was formed under stage two and they worked on the bill to give their recommendation. After they are done, then they will put the bill or proposal into proper shape and then present it back to a speaker of parliament, and then they will have to study it. This is what happens under stage three. So no waste of time. Quickly, they will put it before the House of Parliament, and then what will happen is stage four. Let's go and see what happened at this stage. Okay, so under stage four, a motion is brought before the House for the bill to be read a second time. So they bring a motion. So motion, those of you familiar with debates, yes, so under debates you realize that there is a topic to be discussed, or where you have the speakers trying to put their argument across. Here in Parliament House, the same thing is done. So they call it motion, but in mere English we say topic. So they will announce that this is the motion or the topic before the House, and then it will be discussed. So it will have to be read a second time, and the clerk, as usual, will do that. And then around that time, all the members of parliament have had copies of whatever document or motion or topic they are about to discuss. So that is why what happens at the at this level. Okay, so we quickly move into stage five. So in stage five, it's a quick and a short one. So what actually happens there is that after the motion is brought, so stage five, they will quickly announce for a debate and doors will be open. So the bill will be, so let's look at stage five. Under stage five, the bill is debated and voted upon. So the bill is debated and voted upon here under stage five. So around this stage, we know debate is one of the things that members of parliament do. So they have a formal discussion, they put their argument across. So what they have read or heard so far, what do they think about it? So this is actually the first one that will occur before the next one. So whether they should continue with the process or end it there. So this will take place over here, and all of them will judge or put their views across. So then they will be given the chance to vote either yes or no. Alright. So that is what happens at the stage five, after the stage four, where the motion is put before the House and then is being read second time. Okay, so that is what you have over here. Now we'll go to, after this activity, what then is next? So we'll go quickly into stage six. Okay, so at stage six, a thorough discussion is held and then changes are made. Remember, under stage five, they have a debate and then they decided to vote whether to continue with the process or not. So certain parliamentarians or members of parliament to express their views and their concerns. So if there is a need to make changes, it will be done quickly. And the changes could be in the form of subtractions or additions being done to the issue under discussion. And this is what happens here. So they do this under stage 6, and then it will progress to the next stage, which is stage 7. I hope you understand this. Now, take note over here that this stage is called the consideration stage. Consideration stage where a thorough discussion is held and then changes are made, either to have additions or subtractions made to the motion or the deal or the proposal. Good. So now let's move to the next stage, stage 7. Okay, so at stage 7, this is what happens. Parliament votes to reject or approve the deal by a simple majority. So there should be an approval. After the additions and the subtractions have been made, then it will progress to the next stage. And this is that stage where you have to what? Approve means that you must get a number that will say yes to the bill, that it should continue and move to the next stage. The rejection or reject means that they need a number that will say no to the bill or to the motion under discussion. Alright, so that is what happens at stage 7. And take note, here in Parliament, they need a two-third majority. Two-third majority, that's 2/3, those of you who do that fraction. So what is happening here is that if we have currently, we have 275 members of parliament. The number could increase. Like as of now, we have 275 members of parliament. So out of this number, two groups, or if we divide this number into three, two portions of that three should agree or should approve or reject, and they will carry the vote on that day. They will carry the vote on that day. So this is what has to be done at stage 7. Then if there is an approval, it moves to the next stage, which is stage 8. But if there is a rejection, then it has to go back for a review. Then the process will start afresh again. But reasons will be given why the rejection is being put across. So we move to stage 8 and see what happened. After two-third majority have approved the bill or the proposal. So stage eight. So the bill is sent to the Attorney General's Department for it to be written in a legal language. That is what happens at this stage. So after the debate, stage 6, stage 7, then they went on to vote, and then two-third majority approved. Then it's getting close to preparation, and it's getting close to readiness. So almost becoming well-cooked, becoming a full law. But it has not become a full law. It has to get to other few stages before it becomes a law. So at this stage, the Attorney General will receive it and write it in a legal language. There is always a legal language, because in terms of law, they have their own language. They have their own English, not just mere English. So when you read, you know there's a force, there's an authority backing the language, the choice of where they use. So they will put everything into that particular legal language we are talking about. So here in Ghana, the Attorney General is a member of the executive, so not the judiciary, as some students mistaking him or her for. So we have the Attorney General, and in our country, currently we have a she. So she is the Minister of Justice. So Minister of Justice. So people will describe her as the government in powers lawyer or the government's lawyer. And not just so it is Ghana government for that matter. So if a party is elected into office and the head of that government, that is the president, will have to appoint the attorney general. And this attorney general will be the one who will defend the country if we have international cases. We have cases, for instance, when we had oil disputes, talking about the Cape 3 point, where the Ivorians were claiming that the oil field is actually in their territory. So they had to take that case to the International Court of Justice, and we have to represent. So they don't take all the lawyers in Ghana to that place to represent Ghana. So the attorney general will be the one to go with some other official. So that is what he or she does. But we are the she, every government will have to do that, appoint the head of government, the president, appoint the attorney general, who is also the Minister of Justice. And this person is the one who writes the bill given or brought before him or her into a legal language. That is what happens at stage 8. So after stage 8, we get to the last two stages. So stage 9, what happens at stage 9? Okay, so look at stage 9 now. So at stage 9, we have the bill being sent to the president for his signature. So after it gets to the attorney general, from there, and it has been written in the legal language, it has to get to the president of the republic. So the president of the republic is the head of the executive. Yes, so the head of the executive, the head of government, and the head of state, if the country is actually having just one head for the two position. So the head of government, head of state. So in Ghana, we have the head of government, the same president for the as the head of government and the head of state. Okay, so we have him getting this bill to also work on it, and all he has to do is to read through. If he is okay with that, he will go ahead and what? Sign. And you add that when the president signs the bill, it becomes a law. When the president signs the bill, it becomes a law. So what you have to take note is that the president's signature is also referred to as the presidential assent. So that is an assent. So in some languages or in some other terms, people say the president assents the bill. The president assents the bill. It's one of the core duties of the president to do that as far as the powers of the arms of government are concerned. So we have him signing the bill to become a law. Then when the bill is signed, it automatically becomes a law. So what happens? So the public must know, must be aware, and must be officially documented. So they will publish them in daily newspapers. The media will also try to read portions of them or the entire thing and discuss them for the public to know that there is a new law, there's a new law, there's a new law. They tell people about it, and at all levels, people will also get access to the new law. And the 1992 constitution will be updated because the new law has been set. In subsequent lessons, we'll be looking at how the 1992 constitution was made and how they drafted that constitution. And we can clearly, we are definitely going to see these steps being followed. Right? So we actually have them in that book. So we have really used the written constitution. So the 1992 constitution of Ghana will be updated after a new law has been made, or if there is a change, which is called amendment, that has been made to any portion of the law or the set of law, the constitution. Okay, so that is what happens at the president's office. Then we get to stage 10. So stage 10 is just simple. told you about the official publication, and that we say that the law is gazetted. So at stage 10, the law is gazetted. So that means that it's officially published. So a gazette could mean an official publication of something, of a document backed by an authority. So that is what happened. So all these put together, you have a summary, simple summary. So you realize that there was a first reading. So after the first reading, you have the second reading, then from there we had the committee, the consideration stage, and then we had a committee stage, and then we also have the promulgation. So the third reading before the promulgation stage. So the promulgation stage is actually referred to as a signing stage. So promulgation. So the word. So which stage of lawmaking is also referred to as the promulgation stage? So this is signing stage, that was stage 9, where the president will have to assent the bill. So these are the stages of lawmaking by parliament. In parliament in Ghana, this is how laws are made for our country and for my country, Ghana. So we've succeeded looking at these processes. One day you also become a member of parliament, or my member of parliament. So I expect you to know this before you get there, and then read more about our constitution so that you'll be aware, and you also be familiar with the basic laws, our fundamental laws, and you can also make good laws for the state. I wish you well in all your efforts, your attempts to study hard and get a good grade in this particular subject. For now, we've been able to look at all these things. Keep on revising. You watch the video over and over. You can put these in your words, but do not miss the key terms or the keywords, and the stages must be followed. We are able to do this. I see you getting the full mark for a question that comes under this particular subtopic. Well done for watching this video. Keep liking, keep subscribing, put your comments there. Your questions as well are all welcome. For now, that is what we can discuss for today. Another time, we'll look at more under this particular topic. And thank you for watching. This is JCL Tutorials, where social studies is made simple. Bye. See you again.